It's the Brain and Mohan Show. It's the Brain and Mohan Show. The Brain and Mohan Show. It's the Brain and Mohan Show.
Guys, this is the Brain and Mohan Show. Thank you for joining us. I am Muhammad Al Darwish.
And I am Brain Mountain.
And we're doing a music episode today. We're going to be focused on our craft of choice here.
Our craft of instrumental
wisdom.
Yeah.
Instrumental wisdom. Yeah. You got a song called Wisdom, too. So.
I do.
Yeah, so what is your name, your artist name?
It's Brain Mountain.
Which is the same as your regular name.
I mean, most people call me Brain. Especially my close friends. My family does not call me Brain. They call me Brian. My co-workers usually call me Brian. My last job, they called me Bruce or Bruce, which was interesting, but whatever. I can be Bruce.
Wow, I didn't know you were called Bruce.
Yeah, it was weird.
You weren't always Brain Mountain, though, right?
I was not always Brain Mountain. I was Brian until I met Glenn Larace and Ian Lauger at Ryan and Kyle Barch's house. They were sitting on a cooler, smoking cigarettes, and they were like, "Hey kid, what's your name?" And I said, "It's Brian." And they were like, "Well, how do you spell it? With an I or a Y?" And I said, "Well, it was spelled with an I." And they were like, "You fucking dumbass, you've been pronouncing your name wrong all this time. It's Brain, your name's fucking Brain." And it was this big joke that they had. And about a week later, my buddy Ryan Barch called me up and he was like, "Hey Brain, how you doing?" I was like, "What?" He was like, "Yeah, you're Brain now. Get used to it."
Wow.
And then it's just been Brain. And my artist name for a little while was Brain Sandwich.
Was that the first artist name?
Actually, no. It was actually the first
Brain
one.
Brain Clippings,
was
right?
Brain Clippings, and then Brain Sandwich, and then I think it was Tom that deemed me Brain Mountain. And Tom insists that the middle name is S, E S S, Brain S Mountain.
Do you have any idea what the ESS stands for?
I believe it's short for Esquire.
Oh.
Which I don't really know the definition of.
How did you go from, being a non-musician to being a musician? What was that journey like?
Well, it started very, very early on. I always had an interest in music. One of the first tapes I remember having with my Sony Walkman tape player. Played cassettes for all you youngins out there. Look it up. They're cool. It was a Billy Joel tape. And I fucking loved it. I loved that tape. I would fucking rock that shit out. I'd go outside and I'd put my sunglasses on. And I'd put my headphones on. And I'd put my cowboy boots on. And I'd just fucking sit there and listen to Billy Joel. But the reason I started there was, when I moved to where I live now, Ludlow, Massachusetts, I was in East Longmeadow, as a small child. I moved here in the summer of 96 or 7, somewhere around there. And, so I started second grade here. And I wanted to play music, and I met our mutual great friend Thomas Lopes in second grade, and he was really into music as well. His brother Frank was...
Was he already playing it at that time?
At that time, when I met Tom, I don't know that he had... I don't know for sure that he had been playing any instruments. His older brother...
But probably soon after you guys started playing.
Soon after, yes. So we always talked... We would talk about, like, you know, we got to start a band. Like, I'll play the guitar, you play the bass... We got to find a drummer. We got to find a singer. And this is second grade. when we first met, like, we're talking about this stuff.
When I was in second grade, I literally was like crying for no reason.
Well, I did that too. I shit my pants one day. I cried a lot in second grade.
Yeah, no, I actually had to skip second grade, and I cried about that because the kids in third grade were mean to me. I thought they weren't being mean to me. They were just like,
they were just dumber than you.
Yeah.
they were dumber and jealous.
No, they were just like bigger than me, and I was intimidated, I guess, because I'm a little baby.
Yeah, but they should have been mentally intimidated by you because you were there.
That's probably what it was. Yeah, who knows?
Yeah, they were probably just like, oh shit, this kid's smarter than us, or at least as smart as us.
At the time, definitely not anymore.
Yeah, no, I mean, this is little kid shit.
Yeah.
So anyway... Even in second grade, when I first met Tom, we were talking about, like, making a band. And I decided that I wanted to play the guitar. And I told my parents, and they bought me a guitar. And they, you know, paid John Cantalini.
Great. For lessons? Really?
Yep, for lessons. John Cantalini.
So you're classically trained guitarist, technically.
Second grade. Actually, third grade. Third grade, I started playing the guitar.
Maybe not
taking lessons.
Yeah.
So third grade, I started taking lessons, and... I took lessons for 2 or 3 years, took a break, you know, kind of just played on my own again, and then I started going back, you know, 2 or 3 years after that for another year or two. And John's he's an amazing guitarist. Anyone listening, look up John Cantalini. I don't know, you know...
How to spell his last name?
Not off the top of my head.
Cantalini.
Cantalini. Cantalini.
J-O-N. C-A-N-T.
J-O-H-N.
Oh, J-O-H-N.
J-O-H-N. C-A-N-T-A-L-I-N-I, maybe, something like that.
We got you close enough that you should be able to figure it out if you want to. So he's a good guitarist. Can you describe his style?
He's kind of like a fusion, maybe. Like, He's just an amazing guitarist.
Smooth and clean and buttery?
Yeah, smooth, clean, buttery. Like, some of the stuff that I have is you know, him jamming with his jazz buddies, and it's like some of the coolest stuff, because he had this synth pedal that came with its own, you had to install its own pickup, and yeah.
Anyway. So those were good. Those were fruitful lessons. You enjoyed learning from him.
Oh, yeah, dude. Oh, man. He would be like, every lesson he would say, so, you know, what have you been playing this week? And, you know, I'd be like, oh, well, I kind of, you know, was playing these notes, and, you know, show him what I was playing. And, you know, and when he taught me chords, I'd be like, oh, I've been playing these chords. I made up this chord progression. And he would start playing it with me as I played it. And then he would let me keep playing, and he would just break into a solo. Like, he was just feeling it out. And, like, I'm a, you know, 8, 10, 12-year-old kid, mm-hmm. and I got this master guitarist feeling out my fucking... Mm-hmm. My rhythm.
So this is a...
It always threw me off when he went from playing the rhythm with
to
me...
To the solo. Effortlessly switching.
Yeah, just...
So,
but eventually I learned how to, you know...
Yeah, the thing that I learned, and I forget who taught me this, but I learned it, I might have read it, was... Your lead guitar is only as good as your rhythm guitar.
Yes. Eddie Van Halen is a great example of that, because as much as people may not love Van Halen or whatever, but Eddie Van Halen is, you know, he's known as, you know, mostly as like a great lead solo guitarist. Like, his solos
his rhythm,
are crazy.
Yeah.
But his rhythms, and it's great that everybody loves my solos and stuff, but I get almost no credit for all these rhythms I've done. Like, most, at least half, if not 60% of my guitar work is rhythm guitar. And if it weren't for that, putting the groove down, I wouldn't have been able to write the solo, you know?
Yep. I think that when you're learning to play the guitar, you got to learn the rhythm to learn the lead.
Yes.
It's in it's tied together that way. You know, you learn one thing, gets you better at the other. So when did you actually get into recording the music? This is important. The actual act of making this into playable files that you could, you know, easily
okay,
play.
So from a young age, I was fascinated with the idea or the ability to record me talking or any kind of sound and then be able to rewind the tape and play it back. And I was always fascinated by that. So there's... I still have them. I could play them, but it would take too much time. It's just stupid little fucking recordings that me and my brothers would do, like, and they're fucking hilarious. You know, I've actually used some of them on my noise albums. So that's where I started, you know, recording sound. And then later on in life, my father built us a computer, and it was like Windows 3.1. And it had the audio recorder that you could record like a 1 minute audio file. Might have been a way to change that, but we didn't know how to do that. So we had a bunch of 1 minute recordings of us just doing stupid shit. And then eventually I was the program we're recording on right now, my father introduced to me years ago. And we would make ridiculous recordings that were just really hilarious. And then we eventually learned how to use the multi-track feature. And honestly, I can't pinpoint an exact moment in time that we did that. But it was sometime, I want to say, when we were freshmen in high school, Tom and I. So that was probably... 2003, 2004-ish, 2004, 2005-ish. No, we graduated 2007, so probably 2004-ish. We really started to figure out the multi-track feature of this software, and started recording songs then. And it was mostly keyboard, playing keyboard. We didn't really. Some of it might have been direct in, but we didn't really think of that. We had a Hey You Pikachu microphone. From the video game, from the N64, for all you youngins who don't know what the fuck that is. And we would hold that, one of us would hold it next to the speaker of the keyboard, and we would play the drum track and then loop it and all that and yada, yada, yada.
Yeah, okay. So, what did the earliest recordings sound like?
Some of them sound like complete garbage. Most of them do. I've got a lot of songs that just sound like garbage, but I still have them. I still save the sessions. I still have them, and I cherish having them and being able to...
You're talking about sessions from back in when? When is this, 2004?
So, yeah, 15 years ago, at least, you know, or maybe at most 15 years ago. Yeah.
You still have those sessions?
I still have a lot of them. I still have a lot of stuff that, you know, I play it back and I'm like, wow, I couldn't sing. I couldn't do this. This sounds like fucking complete shit.
How did you learn how to sing? Because I assume that you were a person that didn't just sing.
Yeah, it took a long time. My voice was really bad. Like, I could bring up sessions right now where you'd be like, wow, that just fucking sucks. Or at least I think that. You know, like I remember showing a song to a friend's brother and he started laughing and he says it sounds like a bunch of fucking gnomes singing, you know.
Whoa,
like, and
gnomes,
And I was like kind of offended by it because but once he said it, it sounded like a bunch of fucking gnomes singing.
Yeah,
it
took me that a sounds long, good.
Right.
Gnomes.
Yeah.
Lawn gnomes.
I
was in a band called Lawn Gnomes.
It took me a long time to master my vocal cords, you know. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I did that through singing like to the music that I really loved the vocal melodies of. And a lot of that was like the Eagles, Ozzy. The Eagles and Ozzy were a lot of my vocal influences, yeah. Whether it be Sabbath or solo Ozzy. But, you know, that and the Eagles and, you know, some newer stuff. Like, for a while, I can can taste it on my tongue. Eli the Barrow Boy, the Decemberists. For a long time, I would sing to that and try to mimic his, like,
lispy, wispy
right,
type
yeah.
of style.
But, like, just as like, a practice to, like, you know, so, like, yeah. when I sing, I sound like this. But if I do this with my mouth, I can sound like this, you know? Yeah, it's ways of moving your lips around to make sound different, as well as your vocal cords, you know, like...
As well as... Mickey Mouse is all of a sudden...
As well as your vocal cords! Huh?
Oh, boy. So, what is it
about... I didn't say she was acting funny. I said she was fucking goofy.
What is it about music in particular that, like, as a format, that draws you, you know, the artistic side?
I just like to make... noise, I guess. I like to make noise that sounds good to my ears. I've always had very sensitive ears. If something's out of tune, in something that I feel should be in tune, it destroys my ears. But at the same time, I love taking like an oscillator, having one tone, and then fading another oscillator and hearing these wonky ass fucking things that just destroy your ears, but it's like this, you never hear it anywhere else. You know, it's the only way to hear something like that. It's almost like it's seeing something that you've never seen. You know, it's almost easier to make a super obscure sound. It's almost like just throwing a bunch of paint on a fucking canvas, you know? Like, I really just like to hear sound. What was the question?
Yeah, that was a great answer to the question. That was, what is it about music in particular? So, like, the fact that there's no visuals, the fact that, you know...
Right, sound. Yeah, I music videos, some of them are cool, but I sometimes, you know, if the first time you hear a song, you're watching the music video, it's never going to be as enjoyable.
That's a good point. Damn, I've never really thought of it that way.
And that's why I like a
the best
lot of,
memories
like,
if, I have are without the visuals.
If I love a song and I tell somebody, oh hey, I love this new song, and they say, oh, have you seen the video? And I'm like, no, I don't want to see it. No. Oh, you have to. It's great. Blah blah blah. As soon as I watch it, it ruins the fucking song. I hate music videos, except for Aphex Twin. Aphex Twin has great music videos.
Well, those are more like visualizers, right?
Right, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like,
visualizer is okay.
Perfectly
videos,
fits. I mean, some
much.
Videos that amplify the effect of the song sometimes, you know. Yeah. But for me, like, it seems...
It's always better without them.
Yeah,
it's always better when you just listen.
Listen, for the first time.
Then you
time,
hear extra stuff instead of splitting your attention
that's,
between
that's
the visuals.
That's the very important thing, is that the first time you hear a song... Don't let it be a video. And if somebody's showing you a music video, just close your eyes and just listen to the song, you know?
That's amazing. So I have another question. I have a couple more questions here. Actually, you know, one thing I was wondering is could we hook up the, audio for like a clip so we could play a song of yours here? All right. So we got that audio set up and this song is one of yours and I want to play it in full and then talk about it a little bit.
Okay.
But I've got it. got much, but I've got it all for you. I know it's hard the way things are, but I love you. I know it's hard the way things are.
The Way Things Are, off the mountain, off the album Reboot the Universe.
Reboot the Universe.
So can you tell us a little about that song? What's about? What? How did it come to be?
Came to be from a someone I cared a lot about that I lost, and I was kind of not able to accept it yet, and that was just the way I felt at the time, you know. There's a lot to it, but you know, I might be poor, but I feel so rich when I'm with you, you know. Like, who cares if I don't have a lot of money, you know?
Yeah.
What, you don't feel this either kind of thing, you know?
Wow. Yeah, it's a beautiful song. I liked it a lot, and it's one of the few songs in this album in particular that are any kind of positive, you know, like the other ones are very dystopian.
Yeah. I was, you know, quite that was the one kind of hopeful thing, you know, and I was obviously in a slightly better mood, but it's also got a very sorrow, sad kind of tone to it, you know.
Yeah, and you know what? Another thing is, it could be about your pet. It could be about a little baby or something. You know, it could be about anyone. Love between any two people.
Yeah, it could be.
Or animals, living things.
Well, that's the beauty of you know, writing a song. I mean, it means something to you, but it could mean anything to anyone else. That's why people love music. It means things to them, even if it's not the same thing, not the same intention that the artist meant, as you know, as long as they feel something.
So
whether it's the lyrics or the music itself.
So you're going to continue making music for these reasons?
Yeah, I mean, I you know, I make music as sometimes it's just a therapeutical thing.
Therapeutical. Cutting your cuticles.
But you know, a lot of my songs, you know, made with the intention of you know, I just want people to listen to it and whatever they think of it, cool. Like if you don't like it, then don't listen to it. Just don't, you know, don't be like, oh, this fucking sucks, beer.
So, what project would you say you're most, like, proud of? Or, you know, what's your favorite of your own projects?
That's hard to say. I mean, I'm very proud of Galactic Rotation because there's so much to it. But that album, like, really drained me. It really drained me, and that's
talk
why
about
there's...
That.
Well, I mean, you know, I the whole idea of it was just, you know, if I wrote something, just, you know, write it and record it right away, you know, and just and do that and then get all these songs together. I feel like the idea was to record throughout an entire year of just a bunch of spontaneous things And you know, it's that's more of a solar, you know, you get the Earth around the Sun, but I thought of it as a more of a galactic, you know, think bigger, you know, so the galactic rotation. But then the things after that, you know, there is the Solar Location EP, Reboot the Universe.
So are those in the same sort of stratosphere as the you know, the Solar Location?
Right. They're okay. So yeah, Solar Location EP is basically an extension of Galactic Rotation. The centerpiece of Galactic Rotation, there's a lyric line that's, you know, Solar Location. As, you know, I say that, and there, and that's where the Solar Location EP came from. And the Solar Location is implying, you know, referring to, you know, the Earth's place.
So we're talking the best Brain Mountain, like the stuff you're most proud of, includes Galactic Rotation, Solar Location, and what other?
Reboot the Universe was that was a very, very sad album. I was going through a lot, you know, between the loss of love type thing and loss of a wonderful friend, you know. But I am very proud of those songs, and then there's a few songs that I don't know that are actually on the that album or any album that I did write that are like really cool.
Tell me about your biggest failures.
My biggest failures. That's like a deep.
Musically. Yeah.
My biggest failures. The
floppiest albums you made. The albums you made that you don't care to listen to anymore.
I don't know. I listened to them all.
That's cool.
One point or another. The failures are the things that no one ever heard. There's plenty of sessions that are just like, you know, they had so much good intention, but I couldn't make them sound the way I wanted them to sound, and they're just horrible, but I still have them because they're a piece of time and they were recorded. It's a recorded piece of time, so why delete it, you know, unless it's something really, really horrible.
Yo, what was that song we were listening to earlier? The other song, The Crumble? I'm looking for that here. Okay, so yeah.
It's closer to the bottom of that list.
Yeah, so we're going to play another track here because it's not enough to play just like one or two. You know, the intro was your song and we played The Way Things Are, but we got to play at least one more song here. This is The Crumble, and what album is this off of, or is this just a standalone?
This I believe this was on, it was on an EP. I don't remember if it was the Solar Location EP or not.
All right, well let's play it, and then we'll talk a little bit about this song too. Thank you.
So yeah, that kind of. I remember. So that the piano line was on. Remember that Baldwin electric organ I had.
I think so.
It was there forever.
It's big, right? The big one.
Big, yeah.
A friend. Oh yeah.
A friend of ours has it now. But yeah, so that's what all the piano was. So like electric piano, and then like it was like another like weird. It was called an electric organ, but it didn't even have an organ sound. It's like, but it was cool. And then so the lyric idea. For whatever reason at the time, I was really into the idea of singing two different things on different sides, you know, at the same time. So, you know, when it first starts, that would, you know, I had already recorded the vocals. So the beginning, the world is, that's just me fading in one loop and then goes in. You know, and then the first lyric written, you know, the world is crumble, it's crumbling at my feet. And then I wrote, the world is crumble and I can no longer bear the weight. So instead of singing them linear, I sang them on different sides so that, you know, and then right in the center, the world is crumble and I fucking hate myself because at the time I did, but... it's funny because as much as I hated myself when I sang that lyric and listened to it back, I was like, wow, that sounds so good. You know, and I fucking hate myself. Yeah, I was like, really?
It's like the voice of an angel.
Yeah, right. And so like, you know, I hated myself, and then I listened to me singing back and I was like, wow, that's really good. Maybe I don't hate myself because I really like that, you know, and I did that, you know, so it's I've always had trouble with stuff like that, self-esteem and, you know.
Well, whatever it is you're using it to create something that's bigger than yourself, and it's something that's separate from yourself, but it's uniquely tethered to yourself.
Mm.
But like you said, everyone can interpret it their own way now.
Own way.
It belongs to everyone in a way now, not just you.
Yeah.
You're the one that created it, right?
I created it, and honestly,
but what it means is created by everyone that listens to it,
and honestly, that's true for myself. You know, there's things that I've written that you know, I didn't really know exactly what it meant when I was writing it. It just kind of worked and sounded good, and it's not until I go back a month or so later and listen to it. And really listen to what I'm singing and saying, and I can connect it to something that actually happened in my life, you know. But like I said, I didn't actually write it about an event in my life or an aspect of my life. But listening to it a month later, something happened between me writing it and listening to it a month later that like really made me understand what I was saying, which is like a strange thing. To not understand exactly what you're writing other than it sounds nice and you can sing it well and play it well, and then listen to it later and really understand what you were actually saying. It's almost like a subconscious thing being realized by a conscious thing.
Wow.
Sometimes. Not all the time. Sometimes.
So my final question that I have prepared is, are you glad that you avoided fame for the most part, or would you prefer to be more well known and more like successful in that realm?
I've never been one to really enjoy the spotlight. I like, it took me a while to be able to play on stage. I had to feel comfortable and feel like I could play and sing to my own personal standards. And even then, like Rain Sun, when we were in Rain Sun, that was the first time that I ever played on stage, and I was nervous every fucking time, especially singing. My singing sucked in all those shows, all those videos. I hate watching because I'm like, my voice is so bad. Like, but I was nervous as hell.
We couldn't always hear ourselves sing.
Right, yeah, you couldn't hear yourself, and it was different. It was a different environment, yeah. This and that, blah, blah, blah. So, I mean, I'm not saying that I had a bad voice at the time. It's just those performances, I feel like I just did bad. There was a couple of them that are really fucking awesome, though. Like... You know, there's a couple times that I really felt great. And honestly,
the one we did at the house party in Connecticut was the ones, best ever.
The ones that weren't filmed were the best and the most fun and invigorating and you know, ego boosting, you know. Yeah. VIP meeting for the band upstairs. Yeah. We just go upstairs and there's just like a bunch of fucking weed everywhere.
But yeah, that was good.
We were treated like celebrities at that moment, and it felt kind of good. But at, you know, for your question, I feel like if I was famous, I would be just like an asshole because I hate. And I love that people love what I do. But if there were like paparazzi, like I would just straight up just knock out anybody taking pictures of me for money.
Yeah.
Well, it's like, if you want money, just ask me. Like, I'll give it to you. Don't take a picture of me and sell it to somebody. Like, just ask me for money and I'll fucking give it to you.
Like $5 a month Venmo?
No, dude. Like, if I was rich and famous and some dude was like taking pictures of me from across the way, I'd be like, dude, just take $1,000 and leave me the fuck alone for the rest of your fucking life. Because that's what you're going to get for a picture of me.
Right.
You know what? Here's $10,000. Like, if I was fucking a millionaire, dude, I'd be like, just take the fucking money and stop taking pictures of me.
Damn, dude, you're encouraging people to do that, because I would want $10,000 and I'd want to fucking come take pictures of you.
Yeah, but nobody else is going to do that. I'm not rich and famous.
Yeah, that's what you're saying. All I can think of is Ringo Starr. He said, fame is one of those things that once you get it, you can't give it back. You know, it's one of those things that...
Once you're famous, and especially, like, if you fuck up, like, you're always a fuck up.
Yeah. Yeah, but, I mean, in my opinion, the Brain Mountain, the music, you know, it's as good as anything else.
Well, it's good
to
hear.
As any other artist.
It's good to hear.
Yeah, and I hope that people recognize it someday.
I just want people to hear it. For years, it was free on my Bandcamp. And now it's not. But if all y'all want some fucking free music, just because I want you to hear it, I'll make it all free again.
That's probably a good idea. So
I'll make it all free again, but you have to fucking like comment.
Yeah, or comment post, and subscribe.
Subscribe and post a comment on our what it, Facebook or whatever.
YouTube and Facebook,
and let me know.
All right. Thanks for listening, guys.
If you want my music for free, let us know. If you don't, I'm going to make it more money.